Hi, it's Rick, and it's time to wrap up my bike trip trilogy. The first step, like the other trips, is to get far away from home in the shortest amount of time. So I left home on the morning of August 1st and stopped in Portland, Maine for the night. On the second night, I camped in New Brunswick at the Bay of Fundy before crossing the bridge onto Prince Edward Island and returning by ferry. Once back on the mainland, I continued on to the end of Nova Scotia. By the time I got to the Bay of Fundy, I couldn't wait to set up camp and sit down to a nice, relaxing meal. The Guinness Book of Records says that the Bay of Fundy has the world's highest tides at over 45 feet. I was glad to see the bay at low tide. At high tide, it looked like any other seashore, but at low tide, the water recedes as much as 3 miles and exposes the ocean floor as far as you can see. The Confederation Bridge is 8 miles long and at the highest point is 200 feet above the water. After 8 hours on the ferry to Newfoundland, I arrived in the evening looking for a place to camp. It took most of the next day to finish the 600-mile ride to St. John's and Cape Spear, the easternmost point in North America.
Right over there's a guy standing on the corner. He's going to send you down.
Thank you. Indian smoke is an emergency, so.
Till I die, I'm proud to be an Islander, and here's the reasons why. I'm free as the wind and the waves wash the sands. There's no place I would rather be than here in Newfoundland. I spent some time in New York State and nearly lost my mind. The city life's too fast for me, nobody had the time. Cement and steel and flashing lights was all that I could see. It may be good for New York State, but I know them good for me. I'm a Newfoundlander, born and bred, and I'll be one till I die. I'm proud to be an Islander, and here's the reason why. I'm free as the wind, and the waves wash the sands. There's no place I would rather be than here in Newfoundland. Now in Montreal, the Frenchmen say that they own Labrador, including Indian Harbor, where my father fished before. And if they want to fight for her, well, I'll surely make a stand. And they'll regret the day they tried to take our Newfoundland. I'm a Newfoundlander, born and bred, and I'll be one till I die. I'm proud to be an Islander, and here's the reason why. I'm free as the wind and the waves wash the sands. There's no place I would rather be than here in Newfoundland.
Thank you.
Heading back from Cape Spear, I went north to the Bonavista Peninsula to see the fishing villages, rocky shorelines, and puffins, then on to Gros Morne National Park and up Newfoundland's west coast.
Sometimes made me cry. She told me of the hardships, and the dangers of the seas that will remain until the day I die in my memories. Brave men, she said, is what they are, those who face the icy winds, knowing when they leave the sheltered coast, they may never ever come back again. Then as the teardrops filled my eyes, she'd hold my tiny hand and say, son, the proudest thing on earth are those little boats of Newfoundland. When the little boats go out to sea from the shores of Newfoundland, God, do me a favor, you guide them with your hand. Protect them from the dangers and the fury of the sea. For those little boats of Newfoundland, Lord, mean the world.
I found a place to camp for the night, 5 miles down a dirt road.
are the Irish fishermen who'll work out on the deep through the storms and winter gales. Might make a living pulling codfish from the sea and hunting for the big black whales. Work out on the Grand Banks in the sun and wind and rain, 2,000 miles from our own land, to fill our holds with saltfish before heading back again from the shores of Newfoundland. Ah, but 9 long months away from home, no man on board can bear. It's a loneliness too hard to stand. We're gathering up our families and we're going to settle here on the shores of Newfoundland. And we brought along our stories, and we brought along our songs, to warm us in the winter cold. Won't forget our history, boys, we'll forget where we came from. For all the trials the time will bring through all years as we grow old. The English guns have brought our troubled country to despair and rule it with an iron hand. We seek out some safe harbor and forget about our cares on the shores of Newfoundland. Seas are full of codfish and the woods are full of deer. There's a peace that's hard to understand. We take our chance on not being caught and make our home right here on the shores of Newfoundland. And we brought along our stories, and we brought along our songs, to warm us in the winter cold. We won't forget our history, boys, nor forget where we came from. For all the trials the time will bring through all the years as we grow old. We are the Irish fishermen who work out on the deep, and it's here we'll make our stand. We're going to make a living pulling codfish from the sea on the shores of Newfoundland, on the shores of Newfoundland.
Several months before this trip, I got an email from a writer named Calvin Whalen asking me about my Alaska trip. Then I found out that he lived in Newfoundland. When I got there, I contacted him and he took me to see the summer's last remaining iceberg. There wasn't much of it left, but a month earlier he took this photo of it.
Thank you.
I had been looking at photos of Western Brook Pond for several years and couldn't wait to see it for myself. I walked the 2 miles to the visitor center where I joined the boat tour across the pond. After the short ferry ride from the island, I started on the Trans-Labrador Highway. At Red Bay, the pavement ends, and it's all gravel for the 330 miles to Goose Bay. At Labrador City, I cross into Quebec and continue on Route 389 to Baie-Comeau on the St. Lawrence River. This complete arc through the wilderness is just over 1,000 miles, and it's been possible only since 2009 when the final phase was open to traffic. They even allow travelers to borrow a satellite phone at the beginning of the highway and return it free of charge at the end. If you've ever heard of the Trans-Labrador Highway before, it was probably related to the amazing snowdrifts that cover it in winter. But I won't have to worry about that in August.
Just sit right back and you'll hear a tale of a fateful trip that started from this tropic port aboard this tiny ship. The mate was a mighty sailing man, the skipper brave and sure. My passengers set sail that day for a 3-hour tour, a 3-hour tour.
Made it to Labrador, and now I'm camping at Pinware Provincial Park. And I heard from the guy at the gate that the black flies are not bad this year. I guess that's relative. So I'm right on the coast. You can hear the surf in the background probably. Can't see it from here, but it's about 100 yards away. We'll be right back.
Northern Lights that shine so bright when the night is cold and clear. The snow is bright from the pale moonlight and silence fills the air. I cast my eyes to the sparkling skies and I can see once more those Northern Lights that shine so bright in the skies of Labrador. This place I've heard in every word is far away.
Oh yeah. Woo. You don't get much protection from them out here, do you?
Not a bit. It helps a little bit of wind.
Yeah, the wind helps. I camped last night at Pinware. And last night the black flies were out and I got up this morning and the mosquitoes were out. Looks like they traded places. Are they going to be paving it?
Up this way. And I didn't have silver on this one.
While I had the camera off, a bear ran onto the road from the left. In the loose gravel, I couldn't stop fast, so I started downshifting and hitting the rear brake. Fortunately, he spun around and ran back the way he came. When I got the bike stopped and the camera turned on, I looked around to see him cross the road like he wanted to in the first place. I went back to see if I could get a closer look, but he was long gone. He's probably putting together a video of the crazy biker who almost hit him. This looked like a good place to stop, but it turned out to be too crowded. I could tell that the grader had been through here and left me a ridge of dirt down the center of the road. I had to make sure my front tire didn't touch that. But when I found the grader, he was in my lane, so it looked like I was going to have to cross it after all. Somewhere along this road, I looked at the speedometer to see that it was registering 0 miles per hour. The speedometer cable had come loose and fell out of its housing. From that point on, I had to use the speedometer on the GPS.
Discovered, unexplored. It's a home for free of spirit. It's a land called Labrador. Legends of our people spoken in the language of the land tell of hard times and injuries. Strangers would not understand as they trekked across the tundra from the highlands to the shore. Promise of the land is broken and our people suffered more. shining glory, let her on the spoiled waters flow. Let her children live in freedom in the valleys of the snow. Lift your voices, sons and daughters, like you've never done before. Let your song rise through the darkness in this land called Labrador. Lift your voices, sons and daughters, like you've never done before. Let your song rise through the darkness in this land called Labrador. In this land called Labrador.
I didn't know it at the time, but Quebec 389 would make the Trans-Labrador Highway seem like child's play. When I came to this, I thought it was just a section of road under construction. After 5 or 10 miles, I realized I was wrong, and it would be nearly 50 miles before I would see pavement again. This road is pretty rough. I'd hate to come through here in bad weather.
On the road again.
Knock it off, Willie. I've never been so happy to see pavement as when I came upon this. Well, this is cool. They made a see-through bridge so you could watch the river pass under you. But it seemed like only a few miles before I was back to dirt again. Now the question is, how long would this one last? Every time I crested a hill, I would scan the horizon looking for a trace of pavement. Well, I've got 90 seconds to sit here in the rain. I might as well put my glove covers on. Yes, I'm back to pavement again. That one lasted 3 miles. That's not a hill in the fog. That's the hydroelectric dam at Manic 5 in Quebec. From Baie-Comeau, it was an easy ride on real pavement to Montreal. Thank you. The St. Lawrence River at this point is about 15 miles wide. At Montreal, it was time for a decision. As of now, I have ridden to all the Canadian provinces and territories, except for one, of course, Nunavut. Nunavut is the largest territory in Canada, is the least populated, and has no roads into it. That's too bad, since it has the world's coolest license plate. But there is a way to ride to Nunavut. The territory includes all of the Hudson Bay, and in a few spots, the boundary touches the Quebec shoreline. That's where Shisasibi comes in. It's part of the Cree Nation on the James Bay in Quebec and is only a few miles from the Nunavut line. If I can make it to Shisasibi and then onto the beach, I can check off all the territories of Canada. But it won't be easy. It's over 900 miles north of Montreal. At Matagami, I'll hit the James Bay Road through the northern wilderness of Quebec. There at the checkpoint, I'll sign in and give my contact details and expected return date to assist the search and rescue if necessary. It's all paved, but the brutal winters have taken their toll. When I get to the town of Radisson, I'll camp for the night and then try for Shisasibi the following morning. The campground in Radisson was excellent. They had converted a mobile home into restrooms, a laundromat, and a dining area for campers. That's where I met a cyclist from Italy named Gianluca. He comes to North America in the summer to ride his bicycle on the most remote gravel roads he can find. I asked him about Alaska's Dalton Highway, and he said, 3 times! We talked for nearly 5 hours about our trips and discovered that we had both stayed at the same campgrounds in Alaska, Yukon, and Labrador.
I was first time in Finland to enjoy lakes, wide landscape, long distance without meeting any place. I was in Norway, in Sweden, then I was in Iceland. Now, in the last 3 years, I was on holidays 2 months in summer and 1.5 months in winter time. So last January and February, I was in Land of Fire and South Patagonia, Chilean and Argentina. I discovered Quebec and Labrador in 2003. I was in south of South America and I met 2 cyclists coming from the United States, from a place close to Anchorage, but so they were Alaskans, sardo, you know?
Sardo.
And I was comfortable because when I talk with an Alaskan, I look to be Alaskan too, because I know every place, every stone, every corner, because I've read almost everything in Alaska, more than everything. So, and they told me, oh, exists the Trans-Labrador Highway. This was February 2003. In July, I was on the Trans-Labrador Highway. And I realized that Quebec is a good starting place because I wake up in the morning at 8 a.m. In Genoa, go to the airport, taking a flight to Paris at noon, and to Paris, taking a flight in the afternoon, arriving, so against the sun. So, yeah, together with, in advantage with time zones, arrived at the evening in Montreal. 1 week before leaving, I place an in-store pickup order at MEC for 128 of this, 96 energy bars, 4 of this, and all. When the next day I sleep in a hostel, and the next day I go with bus and a huge backpack to MEC, I retrieve my stuff, and I take a bus to Baie-Comeau for Labrador and Newfoundland, and to Matagami or Chibogamo for Norfolk, Quebec. Perfect. No logistics. I don't have to organize nothing. I can decide in the morning for the next.
The next morning, I started with breakfast at a fancy French restaurant in Radisson and rode through the rain for 60 miles to Chisasibi. From there, I had another 10 miles of mud roads to get to the James Bay waterfront. I guess the people of the Cree Nation have more important things to do than to put up road signs for insane tourists. I had to backtrack a few roads before finding the right one. Yeah, this looks like the right one. I was a little hesitant about taking the bike down onto the rocky beach with no one around to help if I got into trouble. So I parked and walked down to the water before committing the bike to it. Eventually, I convinced myself that I had a workable route. I started to wonder if the adventure part of this trip was just beginning. You'd think somebody who just rode 900 miles to get to his goal would have a smile on his face. Why is this guy so miserable looking? When I looked back at the bike, I thought I saw it move. I walked back to it just in time to catch it as the side stand was sinking into the dirt. Okay, it was time for me to leave here. But as I started to head for higher ground, the rear tire sunk into a soft spot. I thought at first I was in serious trouble, but a gentle touch on the throttle brought it out of the hole. This stretch goes without saying, I had to backtrack the 900 miles to civilization again. When I stopped for the night in Matagami, I was hungry, wet, and exhausted. But it was only 13 hours since I ate breakfast and relaxed at a nice beach before taking a pleasant 500-mile ride. I guess I'm getting soft in my old age. We'll be right back. The bike seemed to be holding up well, but when I arrived in Ottawa and slowed down for an intersection, I thought the front wheel was going to fall off. I found that the front wheel bearing had disintegrated, and the axle was just wandering around in the hole it left behind. I pulled over and called for a truck to haul the bike to a dealership. We left it there for the night, and the driver dropped me off at a cheap hotel. But cheap hotel doesn't really do it justice. It was a world-class dump. See what you think. By noon on the next day, the bike had new bearings and I was on my way back to the States. The last leg of the trip passed through the Adirondacks and then on down to the northern section of the Blue Ridge Parkway. Thank you.